this evening. I'd like to thank the good sisters, or if any of the brethren brought any food. We want to thank each and every one for the very sumptuous feast that we enjoyed again. So this morning, because we have been eating so much, my family and I, and Brother Michael and Brother Tim Kozad, another good friend and faithful brother, decided we'd go to Krispy Kreme to have some good hot donuts to help the cause, and we had a wonderful time there enjoying fellowship one with another. What a blessing it is to be here at Bellview this week, to study together and to worship the Lord together, to have fellowship one with another in Jesus Christ. We know now for many years there's been a search on for Noah's Ark down in the mountains of Ararat. But I would like to suggest to us this evening that the Tower of Babel has been found. Of course, not the literal Tower of Babel, but figuratively and symbolically, there are many such towers today as the ancient Tower of Babel, as we shall see in Genesis chapter 11. We read concerning the ancient Tower of Babel in Genesis 11, beginning at verse 1, "And the whole earth was of one language and of one speech. And it came to pass, as they journeyed from the east, that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. And they said one to another, Go to, let us make brick, and burn them throughly. And they had brick for stone, and slime had they for mortar. And they said, Go to, let us build us a city and a tower, whose top may reach unto heaven. And let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. They said, Let us do this. They weren't depending on God. They weren't looking to God for strength and guidance. As we've seen earlier this week in Psalm 127:1, Except the Lord build a house, they labor in vain that build it. They were going to build this tower unto heaven. Their desire was not to be close to God or closer to Him, like Enoch who walked with God in Genesis 5:24. But their desire was to make a name for themselves. Let us make us a name. They had a desire for renown. Their pride and their arrogance and self-centeredness is obvious. As Proverbs 16:18 said, that pride goeth before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. And as James said in James 4, and Peter said in 1 Peter 5, that God resisteth the proud and giveth grace unto the humble. And James said to humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and He shall lift you up. James 4 and verse 10. These people were like many. They were not God-centered. They were self-centered. They were caught up in themselves. Someone has said that the smallest package that we have ever seen is a man wrapped up in himself. And indeed, there are many men like that. They are wrapped up in themselves. John Lennon, back in 1966, one of the famous Beatles singing group, he said to the London Telegraph, We, that is the Beatles, are more popular than Jesus now. He said, Christianity will go. It will go. I needn't argue about it. It will go. But of course, as we know, John Lennon was gunned down in cold blood in front of his New York apartment in 1980. John Lennon is gone, but Christianity still stands. The word of the Lord endureth forever, 1 Peter 1, verse 25. But when men begin to feel that they are in the place of God, or they are bigger than God, or they are as smart as God, indeed they are headed for a fall. Jesus said, Whosoever exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. Matthew 23 and verse 11. Paul warns us that a man is not to think more highly of himself than he ought to think in Romans 12 and verse 3. But we see the people here at the Tower of Babel made an effort to circumvent God's will. That is, to get around it by craft or ingenuity. They were trying to get around the will of God. God, who had said in Genesis 8:17, "Bring forth with thee every living thing that is with thee, upon flesh, both of fowl and of cattle, and of every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth, that they may breed abundantly in the earth, and be fruitful, and multiply upon the earth." That is, to Noah. And then in chapter 9, in verse 7, "And you be ye fruitful, and multiply, bring forth abundantly in the earth, and multiply therein." But the people at Babel wanted to centralize. They did not want to follow God's plan. They wanted to circumvent or get around the will of God. Like many who want to get around God's authority. And Jesus Christ said, "All authority hath been given unto me in heaven and on earth," Matthew 28, verse 18. But we know that God stopped their unauthorized work. He confounded their languages there at Babel. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men builded. And the Lord said, "Behold, the people is one, and they have all one language, and this they begin to do. And now nothing will be restrained from them which they have imagined to do. Go to, let us go down, and there confound their language, that they may not understand one another's speech." So the Lord scattered them abroad from thence upon the face of all the earth, and they left off to build the city. Therefore is the name of it called Babel, because the Lord did there confound the language of all the earth. And from thence did the Lord scatter them abroad upon the face of all the earth. And of course, the name Babel means confusion. God confounded their languages. God brought to an end this great work they thought that they were doing. But now for a few moments, let us consider together, friends, modern towers of Babel. As I said at the beginning, a symbolic sense in which the Tower of Babel has been erected many times since that ancient time back there in the land of Shinar, when people likewise seek to circumvent God's will and do their own thing. We might call that a Tower of Babel. Many times today, people have a desire for renown, like these people did. Often these efforts, likewise, are prompted by a spirit of pride and arrogance and self-centeredness, as theirs was. We see, for example, in Jeroboam, who followed this line of action in order to keep his followers from going away. He tried to get around God's will and centered the worship in the north of Israel rather than in the southern part in Jerusalem where it was to be. We see that he did this because of the convenience of the matter, so that the people would not go back down to Jerusalem after the division of the kingdom and their worship, but stay up in the north part in Samaria with him. In 1 Kings chapter 12, verse 28, we read the scripture as it declares, "Whereupon the king," that is Jeroboam, "took counsel and made two calves of gold and said unto them, It is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. Behold thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt." He had led these 10 tribes away from Jerusalem and the true worship of God. Now he is going to make it convenient for them so they won't have to go up to the mount where Jerusalem was and worship God there in Jerusalem at the temple. He sought to circumvent the will of God and even change the priesthood into that which was unscriptural. Now this leads to the first application that I would like to make tonight regarding modern towers of Babel. And this is in the modern church growth movement. And I would like to fit this together with the unity in diversity movement, because the two go hand in hand. It is seeking for numbers, a desire for numbers and more people. Of course, we would all like to see more people come into the church of our Lord. We would love to see more souls saved. As we read in Acts chapter 5 and verse 14, out of the multitudes were added to the Lord. But yet, if we're going to grow the church the way that God wants, we must do it the way it was done in the book of Acts, when they went everywhere preaching the word in Acts 8 and verse 4. The way for the church to grow is to teach and to preach the word of God, the seed, which is the word of God, Luke 8 and verse 11. Moreover, when we read the New Testament, we find that numbers does not spell strength. It does not equal strength. But strength comes from being strong in the Lord. As Paul said in Ephesians 6 and verse 10, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. We see in the modern day church growth movement and the unity and diversity movement that the change agents and the brotherhood are promoting a common element among, for one thing, and that is the resting, W-R-E-S-T, of the Scriptures. That means to torture and to twist, and Peter spoke of that in 2 Peter 3 in verse 16. And one example that we see being done of this is regarding the unity that Jesus prayed for in John 17. In John 17, beginning at verse number 20, Jesus prayed, "Neither pray I for these alone," that is, not only apostles, "but for them also which shall believe on me through their word," that is, those who will believe on Christ by apostolic teaching, "that they all may be one as thou, Father, art in me and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me." Indeed, this is important to God, that we be one. But the oneness for which Jesus prayed is a oneness and unity based on that which exists between the Father and the Son. A oneness of aim and purpose and love and goal and word. We cannot imagine Jesus Christ and the Father disagreeing in doctrine or in purpose. But yet this is the kind of unity that many are crying for today. That we can teach and preach different things. We can just agree to disagree and we can all be one. We can just throw our arms around one another, even though we do not teach the same thing. This is not the kind of unity that Paul pled for in Philippians 3:16 when he said that we are all to walk by the same rule or standard. This is not the unity that Paul spoke of in Ephesians 4 verse 3 when he said that we are to endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Well, the only way that we can have the unity of the Spirit is to follow the teachings of the Holy Spirit, which is the Word of God. To take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. But there's another example of distorting the Scripture in 2 John in verse 9. This is what the change agents like to do with this verse. In 2 John 9, they say that the doctrine of Christ is not the doctrine emanating from Christ, or that which belongs to Him, namely the entire New Testament. But they say that it's the doctrine about Christ, who He was, the Son of God, the Lord, the Messiah, and what He did and taught. And of course, that's important. But the doctrine of Christ involves more than the identity of Jesus and what He taught and did while on this earth. It is the entire New Testament for which He shed His blood, Matthew 26:29. By so much was Jesus made a surety of a better testament, Hebrews 7 and verse 22. But John said in 2 John 9, whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. And the reason that those in this modern day church growth movement, such as the community church people and the change agents, want to change 2 John 9 to meaning the doctrine about Christ, this would enable them to encircle more people in their fellowship. That all we have to really agree on is who Jesus is. That He is the Lord, the Christ, the Son of God. That we do not have to be in agreement on all the doctrinal points of the New Testament. That we do not have to agree, for example, in the way that we should worship and all the practices and teachings of the Lord's church. That we just have to agree on the doctrine about Christ. This is another example of a modern Tower of Babel, an effort to circumvent the will of God and the teaching of the New Testament. We go back to the Tower of Babel in Genesis chapter 11. They had union, but they didn't have unity with God. All true unity begins with God. It doesn't matter how many people are in agreement with us or how much we may agree with one another. If we're not in agreement with God, then it's a lost cause. In Acts chapter 5 and verse 9, we see that Ananias and Sapphira agreed together. Peter said to Sapphira, he said, "How is it that ye have agreed together to tempt the Spirit of the Lord?" Both of them were smitten with death by God because they had a part in lying to the Holy Ghost. Now they were in agreement, but yet they were not in agreement with God. So people in religion and even in the church can be in agreement with one another. But if we are not in harmony with the Lord and His teaching, then it's not the unity of the Spirit. It's not the oneness for which Jesus prayed. When He prayed that they may be one, even as we are. That is, the Father and the Son, and the Son and the Father. And then, of course, in this movement, in the modern day church growth movement, it is a lot of based on entertainment. That we are going to get people in by entertainment. Brother Grady Pitts, a gospel preacher who passed away several years ago, a friend of mine, he said this. He said, if we hot dog and hamburger them in, somebody else is going to stake them out. And if we do these things to get them in, I believe Brother Michael made that point the other night too after one of the lessons, that we're just going to have to keep on doing these things to keep them if we woo them and win them in by way of recreation and entertainment. Another part of this philosophy is to leave off controversy, to de-emphasize doctrine, to stay away from topics like marriage, divorce, remarriage, and instrumental music, and things of this nature. To be positive, to be upbeat, to have special singing groups, and occasionally we can even have instrumental music if we want to, although we are authorized only to sing. In Ephesians 5:19. And while I'm talking about that, I might as well bring up something else here. The Scripture teaches us that musically, the only thing we're authorized to do is to sing. And that doesn't mean making instrumental noises with our mouth or our voices. Because in that, doing that, we cannot teach. Our singing is to involve teaching. And today we have people in the church that are listening to such things as the a cappella vocal band, the group a cappella, and they're listening to these singing groups, especially among many young people, in which they're making bebopping noises and humming noises and instrumental noises with their mouth. But because they don't use any instrumental music, they allow that that's scriptural. But yet Paul said we are to speak to ourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, Ephesians 5:19. In Colossians 3:16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Making instrumental noises and bebopping sounds and humming does not teach. It does not declare words. It does not fulfill the command that Paul gave in Ephesians 5:19 and Colossians 3:16. And thus we cannot do it with the authority of the Lord. Because the next verse, Colossians 3:17, Paul said, "And whatsoever ye do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by Him." My friends, in the digression that we saw 100 years ago, when the church was divided by the Instrument of Music and the American Missionary Society, it was said that we only retained some 10 to 15% of the congregations of the Lord's church. That is, only that many remained faithful to the truth, that most were lost to digression and apostasy. When you look about the brotherhood today and you see the direction that many congregations, some of which were once were very firm and sound, are now going, we wonder if the same thing is not happening all over again. We know that in many places it is happening again because they're going in the direction of digression. But the Lord told us that the true followers of His would always be few. In Matthew 7, verses 13 and 14, He said, "Enter ye into the strait gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which enter in thereat, because strait is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it." But now let's look at some other examples of modern towers of Babel. One thing that we are commanded to do in the New Testament, and this certainly is not something that we really enjoy having to do, but yet we are commanded to do that. It is the very thing that the Apostle Paul did in 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 20 and 19, when he said, "Holding faith and a good conscience, which some having put away concerning faith have made shipwreck, of whom is Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I have delivered unto Satan that they may learn not to blaspheme." We see another example over in 2 Timothy, the second chapter. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 17 and 18. Here the apostle declares, "And their word will eat as doth a canker, of whom is Hymenaeus and Philetus, who concerning the truth have erred, saying that the resurrection is past already, and overthrow the faith of some." And there are other examples that we could give in the New Testament where those in error who have gone the wrong way are marked and named. And we are commanded to do this. In Romans 16, verses 17 and 18, "Mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them. For they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple." Now how many times have we been told that we should not call names in the pulpit? And I know here at Bellview, the elders here stand behind the marking of false teachers and the calling of names when necessary. And I'm thankful for the eldership here and for the sound preacher that you have and the faithful lectureship that you have every year in which these kind of things are done. But not every congregation does that, and not everyone has that attitude in the brotherhood, that we are to do what the Bible says when it says that we are to mark the false teacher. So I'd like to give an example of how the Scripture is wrested, that is, twisted, an effort to circumvent God's will on this matter. Another example of a modern Tower of Babel. And that is the abuse of Matthew chapter 18, beginning at verse 15. Now Matthew 18, verses 15 to 17 have to do with a personal offense in which one brother is to go to another who has offended him. And it's still a personal and private matter. As we read, for example, in verse 15, "Moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. If he shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother." Well, there are those in the church who misapply this, and they say, well, before you call the name of a false teacher, you've got to go to him. Just like Jesus said in Matthew 18, verse 15. But my friends, let us consider that Matthew 18 is not dealing with one who is declaring and teaching false doctrine. It does not even have to do with a public sin. It has to do with a personal matter between brethren in which one has committed an offense against another. If their logic was correct in which they reasoned this way, then we would have to go to every Calvinist preacher in the country before we could stand up and condemn the doctrine of once saved, always saved, or that you cannot fall from grace. We would have to get an interview with the Pope of Rome before we could expose the errors of Roman Catholicism. Or we would have to meet with the Muslim clerics or other leaders in the Islam religion before we could expose the false religion of Islam. Can we see how foolish that is? Not to mention the fact, and we have mentioned it, of course, that it's unscriptural. Because we are to mark the false teacher. We are commanded to do this. God has given us this command. But I would like to go to another area along this line, or connected with it. This is in Revelation, the second chapter. You can be turning over there. And this is the question about, what about those who do not teach error, but uphold, countenance, or suffer those who do? Now, this is a very serious problem that we're having in the brotherhood today. We have those who do not teach certain false doctrines, but they do not have any problem with fellowshipping a teacher or preacher who does teach false doctrine, or supporting a congregation that upholds or supports a false teacher. Let's look at Revelation chapter 2, verse 14 to 16. Let's see how the Lord Jesus Christ feels about tolerating error on the part of those who do not even teach the error, but yet they are countenancing that error. They are tolerating it. Revelation chapter 2, verse 14 to 16. This is in the Lord's address to the church at Pergamos. This is not the entirety of the address, but part of it. Jesus said, "But I have a few things against thee." Now right there, we know it has to be serious. For the Lord to have anything against a person or a congregation, it has to be a serious matter. He said, "But I have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornication." And then he goes on to say in verse 15, "So hast thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitanes, which thing I eat." So you've got two classes of evildoers here in the church at Pergamos. And those who are being rebuked were tolerating these things. He does not say that they were actually teaching or practicing these false doctrines, but they were simply allowing or tolerating these things in the church. Now what does Jesus say to them in verse 16? He said, "Repent or else." "Repent or else I will come to thee quickly and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth." Now let me ask a question right here. If these brethren at Pergamos who were tolerating those practicing error and those teaching error, if they continued to allow that and did not correct the situation, if they did not, in fact, repent of this, what would the Lord's view be of them? Would he have continued in fellowship with these brethren if they had refused to correct that situation? If they had continued in fellowship with those who were out of fellowship with God, then God would have discontinued his fellowship with them. Why? Well, 1 John chapter 1 tells us why. This then is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. 1 John 1, verses 5 and 6. And so to have fellowship with darkness is to walk in darkness. For Paul said also in Ephesians 5, verse 11, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. Now, my friends and I, let's make another application. What if the other congregations in ancient Asia had continued to fellowship the Pergamum Christians, had they not corrected that problem? Let's just say, and we don't really know if they did correct it or not, but if they did not correct it, those at Pergamos, what if other congregations in ancient Asia Minor continued in fellowship with them, having refused to correct what God told them to repent of? How would God look upon those congregations who knew that they were countenancing false teachers and those practicing error? That is, if they knew and these people did not repent of it, how would God look upon that? Is God going to uphold congregations that continue in fellowship with those who not only teach error but who tolerate error and welcome false teachers? Look further at 2 John 9. John said, if there come any unto you and bring not this doctrine, that is the doctrine of Christ, receive him not into your house, neither bid him Godspeed. For he that biddeth him Godspeed is partaker of his evil deeds. That is to uphold in any way those who are teaching anything contrary to the doctrine of Christ. That is to bid Godspeed to that person. And not only is the person bringing that doctrine in error, but today we need to consider in the Lord's church, because this is a commandment that's being broken right and left, to disregard what the inspired Apostle John taught there is also to be in error. By our practice, by our ignoring what God says on the subject of fellowship. And again, I want to emphasize that true biblical fellowship begins with fellowship with God. In verse number 7 there, 1 John 1, John said, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin. The Bible teaches of itself that the Scriptures are the light. David said in the long ago, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Psalm 119, verse 105. Paul in 2 Corinthians 4, in verse 4, speaks of the light of the gospel, the glorious light of the gospel of Christ. So those who are walking in the light are those who are walking in truth, according to the teaching of the New Testament. And we cannot walk in the light and we cannot walk in the truth if we are, as many brethren are today, walking in open disregard of 2 John 9 through 11. But now, as we move on toward the end of our lesson today, another example of a modern Tower of Babel is emotionalism. How many times have we seen emotionalism come into play when there is a person in a congregation who is walking in sin? And the members of the church, they know what the Bible says, but they don't want to do it. They're emotional. They have emotional ties to this person. I preached in a congregation in the last couple of years, not where I am now, thankfully. But there was a young lady in the congregation. She was even doing the church bulletin. And she was living with a man. And she'd been living with him for 6 months. And some of us didn't even know anything about it, including me. But when I found out, I did my best to begin to deal with it. I began to preach and to teach against these things and what we should do when a person is walking disorderly based on 1 Corinthians chapter 5 and 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. That we are to withdraw ourselves from every brother walking disorderly and is walking out of step with Jesus Christ. There in 2 Thessalonians 3, verse number 6, Paul said, Now we command you, brethren, it's a command of God. Now we command you, brethren, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that is by His authority, that you withdraw yourselves from every brother that walketh disorderly and not after the tradition, that is, inspired tradition, handed down by inspiration to man, not human tradition. Tradition given by the apostles, by inspiration of the Holy Spirit, after the tradition which He received of us. You know, finally, after much teaching and persuasion, they decided to make an announcement of withdrawal from that young lady. And about a third or fourth congregation left. And some of them that stayed didn't seem to have the same attitude toward me after that. That is, not as pleasant toward me. And finally, of course, we left and... But sadly, this is the way with many congregations. They do not want to do what the Bible says when a person is walking disorderly. And by the way, we did go to that young lady in a very loving manner and tried to get her to repent and to see the error of the way before we took that action. And then there are those who say that you cannot mark or withdraw from another congregation. They say, well, there's nothing in the Bible that says you can do that. Well, if the principle that we are to mark and withdraw from one or two or a few people that are in error is true, then why would the same principle not be true of a whole congregation of people? You know, brethren can be so foolish in their reasoning. In Ephesians 5:11, and have no fellowship with unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. It doesn't matter if it's one or two or a few hundred people or a few thousand, it makes no difference. Darkness is darkness and error is error. Let me ask this question. Would God withdraw His fellowship from a wayward congregation? Indeed He would. And certainly, as we said earlier, the basis of all scripture fellowship is fellowship with God. We've got to be right with Him first of all. Obviously, in the church today, there are some members who put their friends and their family and people that they know and love above the truth. I saw this in Dresden, Tennessee, in the congregation there, which finally caved in and compromised. They had relatives in the congregations in the area, the people they knew, congregations a few miles away. You know, they were ready to stand for truth and word, seemingly from afar, but when it got up close, they backed down. They didn't have the backbone to stand for the truth regardless, no matter what. We've got to stand up for the Lord no matter what. And do what's right. It doesn't matter who it is. How much we may know and love that person or those persons or that congregation. We've got to do what the Lord wants us to do. The apostles said in Acts 5:29, and this is a principle we must live by. They said we ought to obey God rather than men. Jesus gave a warning in Matthew 10, verse 37 and 38. Beloved friends, the longer I live, the more I see how much we need this. He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. Well, there are many other things we could talk about tonight. We could talk about the reevaluation and reaffirmation of elders, an effort to circumvent the eldership. It began with the change agents and liberals, and no doubt many of them, they do not like authority, like those in Jude verse 8 who despise dominion. They despise authority. That's one of the main problems we've got today. Even among some congregations, they're not supposed to be in change agentry and liberalism. People don't like authority. We've got this generation coming on that have arrived that we don't like authority. Of course, this doctrine of the R&R of elders later was introduced to conservative congregations via Brown Trail in Texas, with Brother Dave Miller as a speaker. When that doctrine was articulated by him in 1990. And then again, they practiced it in 2002. You know, if that doctrine was employed by every congregation with elders, what would happen to the church? Just think about that. If you look at a doctrine or a practice and take it to its extreme, you can see the end of it. If every congregation practiced that, it would destroy the organization of the church. It would destroy sound congregations. Because you might have an element, it could be the minority of the congregation, weak or worldly, to rise up against a sound elder or eldership and remove those men from the eldership. Because that very doctrine teaches that a scripturally qualified elder can be removed from the eldership. Not simply by a majority vote, but in the case of Brother Miller and Brown Trail, by only 26% of the congregation. Isn't that amazing? And yet there are still people who say that he didn't do anything wrong in teaching that doctrine. In Hebrews 13, verse 17, the writer says this. He said, "Obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves. For they watch for your souls as they that must give account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief, for that is unprofitable for you." That's talking about the elders. We are to obey them. The only exception would be as if they were to tell us to do something that was out of harmony with God's will. In Acts 20, verse 28, "Take heed therefore unto yourselves to all the flock, over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers to feed the church of God which ye hath purchased with your own blood." I do not know of any scripture in the Bible that emphasizes the importance of the eldership or the Lord's church any more than that one. Speaking of the flock, the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood, of which they are the overseers. Now regarding this doctrine of the reevaluation, reaffirmation of elders, it teaches that eldership is to be reevaluated and reaffirmed every so many years by popular vote. We already have a way to remove an elder or elders if they become unscriptural or they begin to walk in disorderly. And for one thing, these other scriptures that we've looked at. But there is one specific, and that's in 1 Timothy chapter 5. We don't need any new found doctrine coming in. And moreover, we are never to practice any doctrine that is contrary to the New Testament. Now, as we extend the invitation this evening, we know that denominational preachers have tried for years their own Tower of Babel regarding baptism. They try to circumvent the command to be baptized by using all these emotional, hypothetical situations. Well, you know, John Doe, he was in his car going down the road to Timbuktu to be baptized. And all of a sudden, a tractor trailer came over on his side of the road and took him out of this world. He believed in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He was going to be baptized. Now, are you going to tell me that man's going to be lost in hell? That's one of those towers of Babel they like to erect, to try to circumvent or get around what the Bible says. Beloved, the Bible says this. The one who died for us and shed his precious blood. And this is where we must stand. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. But he that believeth not shall be damned or condemned. Mark 16:16. We must hear and believe His Word. Romans 10:17, Romans 1:16. We must repent. That means if a person is living in adultery and they want to be baptized, they've got to get out of that adultery situation. Or cease committing any sin that they are involved in. We are to, as Paul said, to repent and bring forth fruits worthy of repentance. Acts 26:20. That's true repentance. That's a prerequisite to salvation. And we must confess the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, before men. As the Ethiopian did, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, Acts 8:37. Then we are not to tarry, we are not to delay, but to arise and be baptized and wash away. Calling on the name of the Lord, Acts 22:16. If we have done this, my friend, but we realize tonight that we have turned from the way. Remember that Satan is going to make many efforts. There are going to be many towers of Babel put before you to try to get around the fact that you need to repent of your sins, to confess your sin, and to come back and to be faithful. That we must repent and pray God's forgiveness. Acts 8:22. We must confess our faults one to another and pray one for another that we might be healed. James 5:16. And we are given this beautiful promise that if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Oh, what a great and wonderful and loving and good God that we have. That He would send His only begotten Son to suffer, bleed, and die for us. And what a wonderful Savior is Jesus our Lord, who suffered, bled, and died for us and rose again. Yes, the Lord loves us, but we cannot be saved by trying to get around His will, but only by doing His will. He said, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. If you need to come this evening, we invite and encourage you as we stand. And we